Okay, for this this talk, I don't really have a title. It's somewhat a narrative, hopefully of a punchline at the end. So I thought I should first give a little bit of background as to actually what I work with, because I don't only work with higher order ambisonics, which is something I've been talking about, I guess, all week so far. I work with acousmatic music and higher order ambisonics, but I also work with live electronics and performers, so I write scores for people to play. And I also work with sound installations. Much of it is interactive. And these are connected together with many things. But of course, one of the things that connects them together is the role of space. And I'm not only thinking about space as spatialization, but space as an element of a musical discourse. So when I first started to investigate space within a musical context, I was very interested in what's happening in the real world and real world experiences. And then, so thinking about motion, movement in the real world, thinking about what happens when items fall and they drop and they smash, all the ideas of causation which connects to spatial behavior. And this is sort of the start. I wanted to take that into a musical context by finding ways to abstract the information, so abstract the idea of the sound object, abstract its behavior, think about the relationship between objects in a space, and thinking about rules that one can use for developing spatial counterpoint and spatial motion archetypes, for example. And so when I'm thinking about abstracting these real-world spatial phenomena, I want to leave something left that hints and suggests, and not removing it completely into total abstraction. So trying to hover in that sort of in-between point of something that's real-world and something that's totally abstract, but trying to hover in the middle to allude to real-world phenomena. So when it came to space as element of musical structure, then of course I needed to start off with real world things, real world phenomena, room acoustics and sound propagation, thinking about how sound behaves in the space. Needed to think about the idea of an enclosure, what happens if, for example, an animal or an object was moving inside an enclosure, what the implication is. I mean, there's some very obvious archetypes. There's the idea of the fly buzzing around within an enclosure, which defines its spatial world. Thinking also about the size of the space and the implication of that based on the relationship between objects. So even if we don't hear an enclosure, we don't have any room acoustics or any room model to give an idea what the enclosure is like, how the objects would relate to each other spatially would give an implication of that, a suggestion. Simple example, hard left and right means you've got a space which is at least a certain size. Also interested in sound identity and how that connects in some way to spatial identity. Some obvious examples, for example, if you hear the sound of footsteps approaching you or moving away, the reason that you know something is coming towards you or further away is partly because you understand that they're footsteps and not some other kind of sound. And then, of course, how this could have implications to spatial development. So how we could piece information through time, together through time in a composition. So presenting little bits of information during the course of the work, and then at one point, the listener has enough information to get that aha effect, I'm here, it now makes sense. So giving little bits of information and so that the listener builds up a picture over a period of time. I talked about sound transformation already in the previous slide. So those were some sort of early ideas I was working with before ambisonics, before I could actually find a way of working with a more accurate presentation of 3D sound in composition. So to sort of summarize that, you could say I was trying to find an illusion of reality and then alluding to it and then find out how that can unfold through time in a compositional context. But then that brought me on to the question of what is 3D sound, because I don't know how it is here, but in Europe particularly, the idea of 3D sound is thrown around in a very vague manner, and I don't think anybody really understands what it means, and I'm not really sure there is a very good definition of what 3D sound is. So I needed to, for myself, make a decision actually what this is, and thinking about it independent from any kind of technology. So how I approached this, I again needed to go back to the real world, and I needed to think about sound as a continuum through space. So loudspeakers, they can define a space, but it often they won't give a sound continuum because you get a point in space because of the sound coming through the loudspeaker. So ignoring loudspeakers and thinking about continuums through space. Thinking about immersion, how we are, of course, surrounded by sound continuously, how sound is all around us, how we can identify multiple things in space because they are separated out in space, so how the real world is a very complex sound environment because of the spatial separation of objects in that environment, how we can understand space through size and mass, how spatial location of objects are stable in relation to our listening point, which of course is something we can't achieve in a normal phantom image. Since we move, the image shifts. In the real world, the objects are where they are, and it's stable. Parallax was something which of course is very interesting when we think about stable relationships of real objects in the real world. And I was also very interested in distance and proximity. When we think about spatialization, often we're thinking about just angular differences. And we're not considering so much the importance of proximity. And so then as a technical solution, this brought me into ambisonics and to some extent wave synthesis. But I'm focusing on ambisonics, and that's where most of what I'm going to talk about comes from. I don't need to show that slide here, I'm sure. Everybody, I hope, understands what ambisonics is. Working with ambisonics took me to some interesting places. Of course, I'm here now because I'm interested in spatial order in ambisonics. I worked for a period of time at ERCAM in the Espace Projection before it was recently closed down for refurbishment. 74 loudspeakers in a 3D array for seventh order 3D ambisonics, also wafer synthesis arrays down each of the walls. I came back to Oslo feeling a little bit deprived, and so set up my own 3D spatial audio system. This is the motion capture lab at the University of Oslo. I used to work there part-time in a researcher position. I don't anymore, but luckily I still have access to this lab. And it's a 43 speaker 3D setup in a very suboptimal space, I must say. Quite a low ceiling, not brilliant acoustics. But there are 47 Genelec speakers. And there is actually a small wavefield synthesis array at the back there, which was used for some testing. A few other spaces where I've been playing with 3D sound. This is Mumet in Graz. It was quite a nice loudspeaker array which can be moved around because it's motorized. So, how this moves into my composition? Well, I needed to find a way to control space in composition. And one of the problems is that when you record sound with an ambisonics microphone, it can be very difficult to transform that sound and not lose the spatial information. You can perform rotational operations, you can simple things such as transpose upwards and downwards of a tape transposition, but as soon as you start to do any kind of spectral transformations or try to distort the sound field, the spatial quality starts to deteriorate. And it can be very difficult to think about these sound materials in terms of a composition rather than, for example, a soundscape collage. So I needed to find a new way to tackle this. And so one of the two methods, I took it from two angles, and one of them was to, instead of record an environment with just one ambisonics microphone, I would record with multiple microphones where the ambisonics microphone was just one element, and then I would add spot microphones in interesting places. So for example, I got a little DPA microphone that's getting a little bit wet under some drips in the corner here. So I'd have this main sound field recorded on the sound field microphone, and then objects which were interesting in that sound field, I would then take spot microphones and do a multi-channel recording. So now what I have is a 3D, shall we say, we'll just say 3D for now, recording with a sound field microphone, and then layers of mono tracks. And this means that I can now start transforming the sound of these mono tracks, just as if I had worked in a conventional way of acousmatic composition. And then I can insert those sounds back into the ambisonic sound field through synthesis. So I can start to find a way to layer up a composition. I can work with sound transformation, and I can still maintain the spatial integrity of the scene.
And this is synthesis, you mean like an ambisonic encoding?
So this would be a, this, yes, that's right. So I start off, I have an ambisonic sound recording, which would be a first order with a sound field microphone. And then I would have a number of mono tracks of spot mics. And those mono tracks, I can then cut those up and isolate sounds and transform, and then resynthesize in higher order ambisonics another layer. So I'd have a first order ambisonics general layer, which is low resolution because it's first order. But then I could encode in very high-order ambisonics if I wanted to, another layer, which I could play back together. And this helps to pinpoint and articulate information as well as allowing me to transform the scene in a very flexible way.
You're not talking about sound synthesis, but spatial synthesis.
Spatial synthesis, yes. Thank you for clarifying that. So there's another photograph from the same recording session. There's another couple of microphones close by in a tree. Maybe I'll play something now. So I'm going to just jump out of this if I can without... Yeah, I have to do that, I think. Who was at my concert on Saturday? About half. Okay. I'm going to play a short extract from the end of the last piece of the concert. This is now, of course, in stereo. In the concert, you would have heard it in fourth order 3D ambisonics, and it would have been much more interesting than it is here. But it would give you just an idea of a natural sound environment being transformed in this way. So you need to imagine how this would be if it was in a full ambisonics decoding in the room. I'm just going to drop in here. I haven't totally tested the levels, so I apologize if they're too loud or quiet. I'll take it low to start off with. I also am not sure exactly where I'm dropping in. Try there. Yeah, okay. Is that loud enough? Yeah, okay. Thank you. I'll stop back there. So a very obvious example, a clear environmental recording, and the drip sounds, because they're recorded with a separate microphone system, I can do some very simple transformations and plop them back in to the sound picture, and then develop them in due course. If I go back to my slideshow. Yes, but also working that same technique for other kinds of sounds. So this is a picture of a recording actually at the Centre Pompidou, where I have I have an Eigen mic and a soundfield mic in the middle here, recording the complete scene. There's a soprano at this side and a percussionist here. Percussionist has lots of spot mics all over his instruments. So again, a very multi-channel recording, where I have the whole scene of the big acoustic of the foyer at the Centre Pompidou with lots of environmental sounds, people walking around, it's not closed off, there's public there, there's all kinds of sounds in the distance. But then also the close mic sounds on the percussion. I can play a short example from that one as well. It's from a composition called Hidden Values. And this is the last movement called The Lock. I think it's been played here in a concert maybe a year ago. Okay, so I shall drop in halfway through, so I don't have to play the whole thing. If I take it from here, maybe. Maybe from here. Stop that there. So it's maybe less clear example, more to do maybe of room acoustics. But there are, in the background, maybe you heard some sounds that weren't from the percussionist and soprano suggesting an environment which they were in.
It was in 2012?
Yeah, that's right. 2012. Yes, okay. Back to my... Oh, yes, it'll come back. Nice. I thought I had to restart it. So one of the other which I'll show another few pictures. So I'd also work with this multi-channel recording technique on instruments, close-up instruments. And so underneath here, you've got there's an ambisonics microphone. It's the SPS 200 sampling microphone. Then I have a cardioid at the top, and then two more alternative cardioid microphones on the side. So again, a multi-channel recording of a single instrument, so I can also control the sound picture in a similar way. In addition, I was working with beamforming of both the Eigen mic recordings and also the sound field first order recordings to isolate information from the sound field. So if you think you've got a complex sound field and there are items in that sound field, using beamforming to take out that sound, you could say, and put it onto a mono track, which I could then work as if it was a spot mic recording. Very interesting, because you can start to decompose the original spatial recording and then also extract data from that, spatial data. Less interesting in terms of the sound quality. Of course, the actual quality of that sound you've taken out through beamforming is never going to be as good as the quality of having recorded that sound with a mono microphone to start off with. But nevertheless, there's another layer of interesting information which can be used in composition. Okay, so let's move on then. So all this work with spatialization and spatial audio and finding ways to connect to real world spatial images, it took me on to a new phase. And I wanted to find out whether the characteristics of human physical motion could be harnessed in 3D sound. This also has a long sort of history, I think, in an acousmatic compositional tradition, where composers are often trying to capture agency through their sound recordings. So the way they record the sound, they record them in a way where, although you don't actually hear the action that went into making that sound, they're trying to capture it in some way to do with how the sound then behaves, and so implying causation. And then, of course, when the composition is performed through stereo sound diffusion in the traditional way, where you have a stereo source and you diffuse this over a loudspeaker orchestra and try to perform spatial movements, often composers and performers would be trying to unfold that sense of agency or spatial agency live in a concert performance. But for, I guess, since the beginnings of acousmatic music, this has always been very vague and something which is more of an intuitive perspective on composition, and is very difficult to pin down. And I wanted to try to pin this down more clearly. So I was interested to find out whether listeners can identify human agency in 3D sound in some way. And if so, I wanted to find out what the most salient features are in that listening process. And then thinking, well, what does that do for my work? How does that change my compositional approach? I started on a project where I was working with motion tracking. Were any of you at my class yesterday? Yeah, okay, one or two. So this is sort of doubling back a little bit on what we talked about in the class. I would take human movement and track this in 3D space using a very high speed, high resolution 3D motion tracking camera system. And I'm going to jump a slide, because it, there, that slide, that tells us more. So here's me with a symbol, and over my torso and head and hands and over the symbol are these retroreflective markers. And there's a high speed, it's a Qolsys optical motion tracking camera system that's tracking each of these markers in 3D space. And so what I get is, from each of these markers, I get a 3D data set. Okay, so let's go back to my other slide, which was this one. So I wanted to use very high order ambisonics, so not first or second order, because I believe the spatial resolution wasn't good enough for us to really hear the details that I was after. And I was using sonification as a way to turn these data sets from those markers into sound. So what we would now hear is the non-sounding gesture. So of course, if we hit something or we articulate an instrument, you don't hear it until the instrument resonates. But this is the most important aspect for me of that articulation. It's the causation that's gone into that sound. And sonification of these data sets was then a way to hear these non-sounding spatial movements. Okay, so now we go back to here. So, this is a picture of the trace of the markers from the symbol as the symbol moves. I have a video which I'm going to show in a minute as well, but I think the still is actually quite interesting because it shows you actually how much movement there is and the nature of that movement in quite a nice way. So briefly about the sonification before I play a sound example, because then you'll be saying, well, how was that sonified? I'm using a parameter mapping sonification method where each data point from my data set, so this, I should just say these data sets, they consist of X, Y, Z coordinates equally spaced in time, captured at a data rate of 4 milliseconds or 5 milliseconds, depending on the speed of the cameras that have been set. And so each of those points, I use that to trigger a sound grain. The sound grain is positioned in a spatial scene corresponding to the XYZ coordinate. And aspects of the data set, which are derived, velocity acceleration, I use to transform that sound grain, to change its duration, to change its pitch shift, to change its filter characteristic, to change volume, to change the envelope profile. Okay, so I think I will go and into a little video, which is here. So that the people that were at my class yesterday don't get the same video, I'm going to play a different video today, so it's more interesting. Yesterday I showed quite a long video of the complete process of a symbol from the photograph I just showed. This is from a balloon. So this is the balloon sound and a visualization of some of the main markers. No sonification, okay? It's just the sound of the balloon being played. Just as symbols, balloons are tricky things to record with these camera systems, because balloons also have quite a lot of reflections, just like symbols do. So I actually only managed clearly to get stable points on one side, well, three sides and top and bottom of the balloon, but it was enough to make a rigid model so that I could track that balloon in space. Here's my head, which has turned into a triangle. I got a marker on my shoulders. Oh, no, thank you. Sorry, there. I forget, I'm not, I have to turn around like this now, okay. Right, I'll start again. So there's my head, it's a triangle. Here's the balloon with half the markers visible. Shoulders, elbow, wrist, and some fingers. The most important thing here are the fingers, which you will understand in a minute. Thank you. Okay, so you've all played a balloon. You all understand these sounds. Unfortunately, quite poor data on my right hand, but I still got the main fingers, which was the middle finger and the thumb. What this doesn't show is all the micro movements that have gone into making that sound. If I zoomed in, you would see these markers moving in a very different way than they are in this video. And that's something which the sonification can also capture. So here's the same balloon. I get my mouse back, where are my mouse? I'll move it here. With the sonification and the original sound of the balloon, so that you can hear the motion and then the resulting sound. I will make a disclaimer, this is not meant as a musical example, it's meant as a technical example. Oh, I should tell you which markers I'm sonifying, because I'm not sonifying them all. I'm just sonifying the middle finger on the left and right hand, and two markers on the balloon, which I should have written this down. I think it's the top marker and this marker. Now, this is in stereo, of course. It's much nicer in 3D. When I sonified in 3D, I normally put the virtual listening position in the spatial mean of the total spatial data. But of course, you can move that listening position around wherever you want to and have the balloon in front of you or behind you or above or below. Okay, so let's go back to the beginning. Now you know what you're listening to. Okay, so that sort of gives an idea of where this is going. I've got one other example I'm going to play, because then the next bit will make more sense, I think. So this is the balloon, but this is the balloon bouncing around. It's a bit shorter, this example. I'll stick that one there. More complete balloon model. You can see all the markers on the balloon now. Hit the microphone. Okay, and then the one with the sonification. And this one. Right, that, okay, what on earth has that got to do with my composition? Yeah, okay, let's quit those videos and try to explain. Back to here. So, I have these big data sets, but actually they're quite short. I could sit there improvising with the balloon and the cymbal for a long time, but it'd probably be quite boring. And so, I wanted to try to work with the data in the same way as I would normally work with my sound. So when I record source material in a studio, I would then try to segment it into objects, sound objects, or gestural objects, units which make some kind of sense, which I can then work later on in sound transformation. and start composing with them. Okay, so how do I do that with a data set? First, I need to try to work out what is an object, a gestural object. Well, segmenting sound recording into gestural objects is hard enough as it is. Trying to do this with a data set is even more tricky. So what I did then, first of all, I decided I would work on the biomechanical limitations and say, combined with the sound recording, which gave me phrases or larger chunks between 5 to 30 seconds. And then, so I've got a chunk now, and now I want to make that into smaller and smaller chunks. And so to do that, I had to start analyzing the data and couldn't just sonify it. And there are a number of things that I did. This is just a simple graph or figure. It's actually data from a symbol, not from the balloon, but it's the only figure I had on my laptop to put into this presentation for now. The top line shows motion velocity. The next section shows the RMS of the audio recording. The third down shows the vertical displacement of the symbol the vertical displacement of the symbol and the right thumb, which I was using to hit the symbol. And then by working out correlations between these pieces of information, I could then segment it into chunks, which were shorter than 5 seconds. Not done by any type of statistical analysis further. It was an intuitive decision-making process. Okay, but that's not quite good enough. I'm going to skip this slide. And so instead, I wanted to do it a bit more thoroughly, and I wanted to move into even smaller units of information where I had a set of rules which would determine how I would segment this data into little chunks. Sorry about the text being quite small there. I needed to write it down so I remembered, because it was, 2 years ago since I did this. So I was interested in a process called co-articulation. Now, co-articulation is where units of information get smeared together to create a whole. Co-articulation comes primarily from studies of speech and language and how we produce speech sounds. But it's also very interesting in terms of body motion. So a good example, a simple example of co-articulation is that when you play a scale on a piano, we hear that and the body feels it as a unit, as a gesture. You don't hear it and feel it as the separate notes, but you're actually playing separate notes. So the co-articulation is the contextual smearing of all those notes into one gesture. And this is something which happens, that we find in these data sets. For example, with the balloon, I'm bouncing the balloon around and I've got a phrase, and all these movements, they are smeared together to make a phrase. And I want to pick those apart again and try to identify those units or those notes. To do that, I needed to analyze the data more thoroughly. So I looked at changes in velocity and acceleration, worked out different types of thresholds. So when velocity acceleration exceeded certain threshold values, then I could define that as a point of some kind. And so I ran the data through many different types of analysis. I'm not going to go into too much detail on that because I want to move on. But it would give me something like this. So there's my original waveform. This is the RMS. This is the velocity of the fingers on the balloon, and then the next box down are the positive values of that, based on a moving average, I should say. And then different types of filtering. I would then be able to isolate these little short durations of data, and when they were spaced less than a certain distance apart, I could say they would group together into a phrase. Okay. So now what this meant, in a big summary now, I could take my data set, I can pick it apart and identify the building blocks. And I can identify the rules that connect those building blocks together. So for example, if a motion archetype was to connect to another motion archetype, it would have to be spatially dislocated by a minimum value. Otherwise, it would be a different motion archetype or a different gesture in a different direction. So I can look at all these trends and I can form some rules. And then once I've got the rules, this means I can take one short data set, work out what the archetypes are, and then build up a much bigger data set. So I can now compose a new data set, a new gestural data set, which I haven't performed, which is totally fictional, but it captures the gestural archetypes of my original performed data set. Okay, so now I'm starting to compose my data sets in a similar way to how I would compose with the raw audio recording to start off with. Well, yeah, that's what that says. How does this sound? That's a good question. If I go back to my player here, I have to admit that it doesn't always sound very good. There is a lot of experimentation. But it did get into the beginning of Topology Chamber 2, if you were at the concert on Saturday. And so I'm just going to play the opening of this for just a couple of minutes until I find the bit. And then I'll take that little bit out and play that bit again. So you get an idea. All the sounds here are from the balloon and the sonification of the balloon gesture material. And I think maybe there's one or two of the cymbal sounds that have been dropped in. Let's just play and I can identify the little bit I want to draw attention to. Okay, now this is the start of a fake data set which is being sonified. This wasn't performed in any way. Okay, you can hear that this has been repeated now. I'll stop there. It's maybe not such a clear example. Things seem to get foggy when I start composing with them. I guess that's, I'm allowed to because I'm a composer. it didn't end there. I then moved on to wanting to formalize this further, and I wanted to embark on a proper study to find out whether listeners can identify human agency in spatialized sound. And now I'm hoping I'm going to get towards the punchline soon. So I wanted to conduct some controlled listening tests. I needed a solution for a thorough or realistic approach to statistical analysis. And I have some interesting results from the first tests. So, what these listening tests are about. I'm going to move my coffee somewhere safe there. And I'm going to remind myself from my paper. So, how to capture human agency. This was a tricky one. What spatial source or what moving source was I going to use? I tried lots of things. I was interested in primal gestures. So, you know, basic gestures that we can all understand. Stamping, throwing, jumping, twisting, bending, expressing with your arms, all sorts of possibilities. And I made lots of motion capture recordings of these types of movement. Throwing a ball, for example, both the hand and the arm and the ball being tracked. But I did find there was a problem in the sonification of these motions. They were very loose, and I'm not sure really what the problem was, and the only thing I can think of is that there wasn't any friction involved. There wasn't any sense of resistance. So I started to consider the alternatives, and I went back to some of my work with a cellist, tracking her motion as a cellist in her previous work, and we started to explore possibilities of a motion archetype based on her playing the cello. And in the end, we came up with a simple bow action of a cellist playing a split chord as two double stops. This was interesting because it had the arm and it had resistance, pulling, the idea of pull. It had change in direction, because as you moved across the double stops, you got a change in motion. It had a change in speed. And cellist being a cellist, she has gesture already in her body. Dum bum, and then the bow releases upwards. I have a little video of this. I'm afraid it's terrible quality because we had the lights were really dark because I didn't want any reflections off the instrument. And then we had the infrared camera setting switched on. But nevertheless, it gives you an idea. Come on, please. Here we are. Oop. There. Okay. Can you just about, maybe just about see that and say it's very blurred? No sound. We're not interested in the sound. I'm just interested in the movement. Okay, simple as that. She did lots of them. We chose the best one. I have markers over her frog, tip, frog, hands, arms, head, body. And I had to decide on one of those markers. Often in composition, I like to take a number of markers and try to sonify them all simultaneously to give an idea of a picture. This needed to be simple. It's bad enough getting people to hear spatial movement on a good day without making it difficult for them. So I need to decide on one marker. And in the end, I decided on the marker which was on the frog of the bow, because there was a lot of change of direction, there was a lot of movement, and it was very close to what was also going on in the hand with the change of direction and change of movement. The tip was too wild. It was too dynamic. So I already had to make a value judgment, what data set to actually use. And it ended up that one. Okay, so I'm not interested in the listeners identifying the action at all. What I am interested in is if they can identify that there is a human agent of some kind, or there's some human agency. So, what I then did was to sonify 12 variations of this motion archetype. The number one was the best sonification that I felt that I could achieve. I'm working in very high order ambisonics, so I was working with sixth order 3D ambisonics because I needed to ensure that there was a very accurate angular resolution in the decoding. So the first sonification was the best that I could felt that I could achieve with the tools and the knowledge that I had. And then each consecutive sonification had something removed. So this is a list. I have these that I can play. I actually only brought the sixth order 3D versions with me, so I think I've got a quick hack to make stereo decodings so we can listen to them on the two speakers. So the first is the original data optimized to bring out all these spatial features in the 3D projection. The second stimuli was the same as the first, but instead of the listening position or the virtual listening position being the center of the spatial information, it's projected in front. So it's as if the spatial information is occurring on a scene or a stage in front of the listener. In the third variation, pitch mapping, I haven't actually defined or said what the pitch mapping or the sonification mapping is, but the vertical movement I mapped to pitch. I mentioned this also in the class yesterday. It's more an intuitive assumption that pitch helps us understand changes in height. And I had a pitch variable, so I decided to use that in the mapping. Velocity was mapped to volume and grain size. So in the third stimuli, pitch, this volume velocity mapping and grain duration were set to their most dynamic ranges, but all the spatial information is removed. It's just a mono sound, which I place on one speaker in the front of the loudspeaker array. So you could say there's all the spatial cues apart from the actual spatial movement. So everything else is there. I've taken all the spatial movement out. The fourth stimuli, this is as number one, but I've reduced the quality of the spatial movement. So we get the global changes of direction, but we don't get the details anymore. So I could say I've smoothed the trajectory. The fifth stimuli, spatial movement is flattened even further. So there's now just three simple changes of direction as straight lines. The sixth stimuli, this is the same as stimuli number one, but all volume variation is removed. Because remember, I'm trying to find out what is, not only can they identify spatial information and say whether there's any human agency, I want to find out, well, what are the salient features of this process? So in the sixth stimuli, I remove the mapping of velocity to volume. In the seventh stimuli, I remove the mapping of pitch. So there's no more pitch variation with vertical movement. In the eighth stimuli, I remove both pitch and volume variation. In the ninth stimuli, this is the same as stimuli number four, but again with volume variation removed. Number 10 is basically everything removed. And then 11 and 12 are simply played at a slower tempo because the sonification is real-time tempo. Interesting to see what happens if we simply slow it down. Okay, so those were the 12 stimuli. How to test for this? This isn't easy. I cannot say, okay, you listen to all 12 test stimuli and you rank them in order. That would be an impossible task for most people, I think. I cannot ask people to give them a score because if I have a very skilled listener, they might have a completely different scoring range than a naive listener who might rate everything very badly. So in the end, I teamed up with a fabulous statistician from the biology department at the university. And we decided on a pairwise test where listeners would say whether A or B in the pair they were listening to had a greater sense of human agency. They were actually given a little script which discussed briefly what they were to listen for, because some people even don't know what human agency is. What do you mean by that? And so we had different ways of explaining that so that everybody would be on a common ground as to understanding what the test was about. So they would rate these pairs. And so each listener was presented with a selection of pairs. There are 66 possible combinations. 66 pairs are too many for a test, of course. So they were presented with 30 test pairs each. The test pairs were randomly chosen, and each set of tests, each listener had a complete different set of tests, and they were independent from each other. And the order which the sounds played were randomized. This is the statistical method which I'm not going to explain. It's a Bayesian-Mallows model for non-transitive pairwise comparisons data. And it's quite a new method which has been enlarged on by a statistician, Marta Crispina, who I was working with. One of the advantages of this model is that it can detect self-contradiction, and it can detect the strength of the results, which I'll show you in a figure in a moment. But even the most skilled listeners, for example, myself, made contradictions. So I would, for example, rate A better than B in one test, B better than C in another test, and then C better than A in another test. So I've contradicted myself. These tests are very difficult. And also, even rating 30 test pairs is a challenge, I think, for many people. So her statistical method can identify contradiction. It can identify the strength of the ranking. Okay, some results. But maybe I shall play you some of the test sounds first, so you hear where we are. So you've seen the video of the cellist and her bow. And we're not going to think about cello anymore, because you're not going to hear a cello. It was very important that these sounds were abstract, because if I had any implication of cello or car or anything that people would instantly recognize, then they would think human agency due to recognizing a sound which they thought had been made by a human. And so I had to make the sounds quite abstract as well, which also put another layer of difficulty on the test. Yes.
How were the sounds played back to the subjects?
They were played back over a sixth order 3D loudspeaker array in the lab, which I showed you earlier. Yes. It was very important not to use headphones, because that removes the sense of tangibility or agency. You needed to feel sound was in the space with the listener. It was a blackened room, so, I mean, they knew the loudspeaker was there, of course, but it wasn't anything prominent to visually distract them. And they were all asked about the quality of their hearing. One guy was thrown out because he was deaf in one ear, for example. That's not a joke, it's true. He didn't realize until we found out. Okay, so the sounds. These are going to sound very disappointing to me on stereo, I know. And I really hope that this stereo decoding works, because I quickly had to make it just now.
Natasha, can you just briefly say what the instructions are that you gave them to think about?
Yes, I can read them precisely to get them correct if I find them here. Don't forget the data, test procedure. Yes. Okay. Yes. Listeners were presented with the following statement. This test investigates the role of sound spatialization in how we may associate a sound that we hear with human physical action. Okay. So that was their sentence. They were told that they would then be presented with 30 pairs of short sounds. And for each pair, they were asked to choose the one that most evokes a feeling of human causation or human physical origins. So I was careful not to use the word agency, because if you're outside the field, then you question what is agency. They were asked to judge a sound as they experienced it in relation to their own body, this being to avoid the listener trying to ascertain a possible real source. And also so that they wouldn't start thinking too much. Because the problem is when people start thinking, they try to make a connection to something which maybe isn't there. So we wanted a quick decision. They also had a pilot test session at the beginning where they could just, a training session, for them to familiarize themselves with the sounds because they're strange. None of the listeners, well, actually one or two of the listeners were acousmatic composers. Most of them were musicians or non-musicians who have never heard electroacoustic music, and their biggest introduction to 3D sound, or sorry, spatialized sound, would be going to the cinema. So these were normal listeners. That was the choice I had. But in a way, that was also very interesting, which you'll see in the results. So, so this is the test stimuli number one. Okay, I'll just see if I can turn it up a little bit. It's quite quiet. Okay. In stereo. Okay. This is, well, number two won't make sense because that's the same, just spatialized further forward. Number three was the mono version. And then this was number four, with some of the information flattened, the spatial information flattened a little bit. Okay, so you can already, if I go back to number one, so you can get the comparison. And number four. Okay. So you hear that they're very similar, but there are differences. It's much clearer when it's moving in space rather than on two loudspeakers. But you get the idea that sounds are very abstract. There's very little to imply something other than the sound in itself, unless you actually start thinking about it and sort of analyzing it. Okay, so yes, the results then. I mean, there's probably many questions that you might have. The listeners were also, at the end of the test, given a questionnaire, two questionnaires. One was the Olin Musical Sophistication Index test to have some idea of their musical background. The other test was, or questionnaire, was a simple four-question test that I had designed to find out a little bit about their spatial audio awareness. So just finding out, do they actually work with spatial audio every day? Because we did have some composers come in. Did the listener choose, for example, a cinema which had a good sound system because they were interested in good sound? Did they play games over binaural? Did they know what binaural was? is? sorry. So that there was a second questionnaire just to try to get some idea of their spatial audio awareness. The reason I made my own was because I actually couldn't find a suitable questionnaire that already existed, which had, unlike the Musical Sophistication Index, which is a well-tested method of ascertaining somebody's musical awareness. Okay, so let me see, it's here. I'm going to jump out of PowerPoint and I'm going to show this, because this is the first part of the results. So what have we got here then? The data for the whole group of listeners was pretty messy and we couldn't find any clear trends. But then as soon as we did a cluster analysis, I shouldn't say we actually, I should say Martha did the cluster analysis. there were three clear groups of listeners, which were obviously listening in different ways because they order the stimuli in a different sequence. Okay, so cluster one, it puts stimuli eight at the top ranking, and you can see that the strength of the result isn't very clear. So I should just say the hot and cold colors, the warm colors, this is a very high probability that that result or that position is secure. The cold colors means that the probability of it actually being there is not very secure. So you can see that this doesn't have a very clear trend. Cluster three, however, is much clearer. So, what does this mean? I think it's maybe most interesting to first look at cluster three and sort of discuss these listeners, who they are, and what they have decided for their listening. Well, they've put S1, S7, and S11 at the top. I was very happy about that because S1, if I go back actually to, can I go back like this? If we go back to the list here. So S1 is the original data sonified to optimize all the features. S7 is the same as S1, but with that pitch variation removed. So there's no mapping of Z displacement to pitch. And what was the other one? S11 they had at the top, which is the same as sonification one, but played slightly slower. Okay. Back to, lost my mouse. Back here, back to the, this one. Okay, and then the bottom stimuli, again, this was very pleasing because S10 was the stimuli with all spatial movement removed. S8, that also didn't have much spatial movement, and nor did S9. So from this group, this group is clearly listening for spatial movement. It identifies a stronger sense of human agency when the sounds are spatialized of all the details. Let's have a look at S3. S3 is the mono sound. I think that's quite interesting because it's not moving anywhere. It's coming off one loudspeaker, but it has all the other cues, the pitch variation, the volume variation, and it's rated higher than these sounds which were moving in space but had everything else removed. So that says something also about this listening, this group of listeners. Not only do they like the spatial information, they also want these other features. They're also interested in the other modulation features to imply what the movement is about. Okay, so if they look at cluster two, not as strong trend as cluster three, better than cluster one, but we do see something different. S10 is at the bottom, so is S8 and S9, so that's very similar to cluster three for the worst stimuli. But the top, we have S5. And I just remind myself. Now, S5 contains the least movement variation, where pitch and volume variation are suppressed as well. So this is a tricky one for me. I wasn't very happy about this group of listeners. However, S4 and S12, they are also quite similar to S1. And the difference is that they're less dynamic. S12 is played at half speed. S4 has some of the variations removed. So as we started to get deeper into what these results meant, it appeared that these listeners simply didn't like things to be dynamic. They wanted the spatial movement, but they didn't want it to be too dynamic. So maybe there was a flaw in my sonification. Maybe I pushed the parameters, the scaling ranges, too far. And so this is an interesting aspect to come back to when I hope I do a reiteration of the test with a different kind of motion data and to readdress that sonification to maybe reconsider actually how dynamic these sounds are. Because if you think about it, you're inside this space, you've got a loudspeaker array, and these sounds are whizzing across the loudspeaker array. And of course it's not real because if they're expecting human movement to be this small thing. Maybe there is a problem to do with scaling and to do with dynamics. So a second round, I would reconsider that to see if these results would then be closer to these results. Okay, and then doubling back now to cluster one. As I said, these are clearly very uncertain results. S1, my favorite, is ranked right at the very bottom. So not very nice. But S3 is also at the bottom. Remember, that was the mono sound with everything else present. S2 is also at the bottom, which was close to S1. The only difference is that it was projected in front. So, but however, S8, S10, and S5, that's somewhat interesting. Now, S8, this contains all the spatial movement. All the details are there, but with the pitch variation and the volume variation suppressed. So again, this could be interesting to point to a different way of working with the sonification. These listeners like the spatial movement. They latched on to the actual sounds moving in the space, but they didn't like my pitch and volume mapping. So it's not necessarily so that these listeners aren't listening for human agency and spatial information. It might mean that they just don't like the pitch and volume mapping. They find that artificial and not human at all. And they're actually just listening to how the sound moves physically in space in relation to them. Okay, there's quite a lot of other things that we found out from this, which I'm not going to go into because I'm running out of time. There is another interesting result. When we start to, that shows the strength of the clustering. It's quite strong, as you can see, the different clusters. This one, the correlation between the questionnaire results and the results of the rankings. That's very small, isn't it? Maybe I can zoom in a little bit. There we go. Okay, so. What this figure shows is the probabilities of my favorite results, which is S1 and S7, being ranked amongst the top four stimuli. And this is the questionnaire based on the spatial audio awareness. So this isn't the musical sophistication index. This is correlated with the questionnaire asking how familiar our listeners are with spatial audio or with sound in space in some way. And we find a very clear trend showing that if they are proficient in some way in spatial audio, then they are ranking the S1, for example, at the top. If we look on to the next one, and this is the musical sophistication index, we find a different trend. How many of these pictures have I got? I just make sure I choose the correct ones. Okay. Yeah, so this figure shows the probabilities of S8 and S10 being ranked amongst the bottom three. Now, S8 and S10, those were the ones with least spatial information. And there's a much smaller correlation here with the musical sophistication index. or much less strong correlation. And what in general we found out was that probability of a person ranking a test stimuli in a certain position was basically irrespective of their musical background. And if anything, there was a trend which pushed in the opposite direction. Somebody who was a proficient pianist or had worked a lot with music in a classical sense, they were rating the stimuli in a reverse way to a normal listener, a student from mathematics or from physics, or somebody that wasn't a trained musician. So there actually started to be an inverse relationship. And this is another area which I'd be very interested to look into in more depth, because I think we can see correlations also with the audiences for electroacoustic music and spatial audio concerts. I don't know how it is here, but in, I guess, most of the concerts that I attend in Europe, you don't find the concert pianist or the person going to hear Beethoven coming to an electroacoustic concert. You hear people come to these concerts that are already somewhat in the know, they have already an experience of spatial audio, and they find that then enjoyable. So there is a training, there's a training process going on here. The more you are familiar with something, the more you enjoy it, and the more you listen, and the more carefully you listen, and the more you become aware of these features. Which I suppose makes sense. But that would be something very interesting to look into in more depth. Okay, so I'm going to stop and summarize, maybe now, try to summarize. So for this test, there's quite a lot of future work, I think, which could be done. Some more interesting studies. With respect to my own composition, I'm still unsure what implication these results have, apart from maybe I will be more careful about not pushing the extremes of, for example, the sonification, not trying to be too unsure, in the sense that I think often we push sound materials in a certain direction. We emphasize them maybe more than we would do because we are in fear that our audiences won't hear it. And I think as a composer, I always have that in the back of my mind. I want to express something, and I'm concerned, well, you know, I hear it, but maybe they won't. And so I then push the ranges, or I push the extremes a bit too far, maybe. And so I think this has made me more aware that I can not expand information just to try to throw it home and make it so blatant anymore. So I think that has a sort of a general result on how I'm now going to start to work. The other thing is that it has made me more, I have more faith in the role of spatial audio and that it can embody human qualities. Many years ago, there was a whole wave of critics of electroacoustic music saying it's sterile and inhuman and alienating. That's why we don't like going to electroacoustic concerts, because it's alienating, because there's no human aspect to it. And I think these sorts of results also contradict that argument very clearly, and shows that we can bring a sense of human agency even when there isn't a performer on stage. Okay, any questions?
Just how you did the survey again, I was just kind of thinking, would having the same group doing the same system actually, compared to listening on headphones, start to actually point towards sort of level the playing field a little? There's a multicultural association when you sit even in a darkened room with a bunch of loudspeakers and that. And actually having others playing those stimuli back in different spatial situations would possibly take away some of the counter.
Yeah, I see what you mean. Analysis. Maybe. Mm-hmm. Yes, of course, sitting in a blackout situation is strange for some people. However, it does have some advantages. It forces you to focus on your hearing. And so these tests are not easy. Yeah. I think it's well known that as soon as you remove the visual sense, the ears liven up and you become much more aware. And I think the blackout room has that advantage, even though it might be a little bit sort of strange to start off with. Nobody mentioned any alienation for sitting in a blacked out room. It was accepted this as part of the test. They knew what was going to happen. So I'm not sure it was a negative thing. The thing about listening on headphones, though, it has its pros and cons, though. It does mean that it is, I wouldn't say more accurate, but it's more repeatable. So I don't have to get people into this lab. These test sounds, they were essentially calibrated to work well in the decoding in the lab. They were made there, they were then played back there to make sure there wasn't any possibility of inaccuracy. So it's a one test situation. To test somewhere else, I would need to make a different set of sonifications which worked in a different space. So headphones would probably make it easier to test many, many people. But again, you still get this sense of enclosure which you have on headphones, which could also be quite distracting from the sense of your relationship to the physical space. Because that's actually, I think, what we're talking about here. We're talking about the listener's relationship to the physicality of the sound that's moving around them, and are they experiencing a sense of physicality in that sound?
You could actually change the scaling problem that you have, like a gesture to the, a really huge, which you mentioned earlier. But the thing I was thinking about is your initial, hypothesis is, can people hear human movement? But you didn't play them any non-movement. So, I mean, you played them degraded.
Yeah, I played a mono sound which had no movement in it at all.
Right. But it was the same gesture, just degraded in different ways. If you really want to hear.
There are many other sounds I would have liked to have added to the test, actually. More reference sounds, for example, completely other kinds of sounds. One of the problems here is that adding two or three more test stimuli would then increase the number of pairs to over 100. And to get any decent statistics, I would need far more listeners than I could realistically get hold of. So we had to make a balance. I had to sacrifice some of my favorite non-human sonifications because of that. And I had to select sounds which would at least help me identify some salient features. Already in the list, you can see there are inconsistencies in that I have, for example, stimuli 4 with only one aspect of it removed, not two aspects of it removed, because I had to reduce the number of stimuli. With a vast number of listeners, then it would be possible to add one or two more test stimuli and still get some results which one can have some degree of security on, because this is Bayesian and not absolute. So,
if I can follow up, the other thing that struck me is hearing these in this setup versus right. It's remarkably different,
isn't it?
It's really disappointing. But I'm sort of curious if you found, in terms of compositional strategies for synthesizing sound, even in a stereo setup, is this useful? This technique. The spatialization, because there are some things that work.
I don't think it's changed my strategy for stereo, actually. I think it has just re-articulated a strategy that I had developed prior to working with ambisonics, is to think of the stereo phantom image as a window on a great depth which one has to address, and one isn't only thinking about the sense of normal stereo, one is thinking about the depth of that image. And so I think it doesn't add or contradict, it just confirms that.
I guess one thing that kind of comes to mind is you asked about human agency.
Yeah.
But it strikes me that you could have asked about real physical agency as opposed to disembodied. So that humans aren't the only embodied thing. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
And I wonder if you can still hear motion as being physical, as being caused without it being human.
Yeah,
specifically asking them about
human. Yeah, yeah.
So I wonder. Well, it was. If you think that question asking showed up in the results.
Yeah, I think. The question that we ask is very difficult because we know what we want to test for. And then, of course, whatever question we ask can be a leading question. And to some extent, one could say this is a leading question. But it also puts them on the spot for them to say, there's nothing human in this at all. Whereas if one just says physicality, or it becomes a little bit too vague, and then makes it more difficult for them to pin down an answer, because they might find this in everything. So although, so you could say it's a leading question, it also is a leading question for them to say no to. So we had many versions of the question. I haven't kept a track of them, actually, until we found one which was most commonly understood amongst listeners, which are just normal people. That we would, I mean, I'd just go out and grab a student off the street and say, I need you for a listening test, and sometimes they'd come in and,
A question that I think is about artistic motivations.
Yeah.
So, specifically with regard to the human live performance elements.
Yeah.
I wonder if you can give us an insight into how you decide who are the correct performers or instruments. For example, with percussion and singer, is the percussion attractive to you because there's a commission, an occasion, a collaboration with a performer? Is it about something discursive with the history of percussion to which you're communing? Is it purely timbral or amplitude or envelope motivations that are tethered to some other artistic agenda with electronics? I'm wondering, can you tell us something about how you come to want
to choose the certain source of whatever it may be, whether it's
on the embodied, physical, present, acoustic, corporeal.
Well, the choice of instrument, whether it's for a source for an acousmatic work or this type of work, or whether it's for a work with live instruments, it's totally dependent on the context. Of course, sometimes it's a commissioner which wants you to write for them, and sometimes one is freer. But just to give an example, for the slide I showed with the percussionist and the soprano, in that piece I had decided I needed something which had a sense of abstract narrative, so I wanted to choose the voice because of the connection, the connotation that would have. And actually the percussion was more to do with a timbral contrast, but also something which was portable. Because I wanted to record this instrument in many different spaces, because this work was also about space and about distance and proximity and sort of building up this repertoire of spatial language for that work. And I needed instruments which could be moved around easily, outdoors, in different recording contexts. And so percussion came up as being a natural choice as a contrast to the voice. Of course, one could have had a violin or a cello or something like that, but piano would have been impossible. And also the percussion meant that I could have one big set of instruments and then reduce it and change it, but it's still percussion. Whereas if I was to do that with stringed instruments, then I'd need a performer who could play cello, a performer who could play violin, a performer who could play viola, and so forth. So it became a practical solution in that context. But the choice, it depends, it's different each time. It depends on the framework of the composition. So there isn't any, I don't choose any one approach. But when it comes to the spatialization side in the acousmatic context, I'm more and more interested with the idea of tangibility. And I'm thinking about tangible sound, and what is tangibility when it comes to sound? Because if something is tangible, it's normally something that we can understand and touch and have a connection to. How is that with sound? We can't touch sound, we can't see sound, but can we experience it as being tangible in some way? And the 3D spatial side for me is that element which then makes something which could be flat on stereo or on the radio or on a normal hi-fi, bring it in this, to the space, defining it in three dimensions, making it tangible. So you have a awareness of where it is in relation to you as a listener, and that means you have a connection to it, even though it's invisible, as if it was a real person in some way performing. And then that might actually change my choice of instrument or sound source. So for example, the balloon was a very conscious choice because I wanted to have a sound which wasn't a musical instrument, but would give a result of something that was very tangible, in the sense that as soon as I don't have the visual information, I'm not touching it anymore, I can create this object which has a sort of a tangible connection in terms of its spatial definition.
Can I follow up on that?
Yeah.
So you've spoken this evening in many cases about in praise, almost in poetic praise, of the human and the tangible and the embodied and these sorts of things. One infers, obviously, the extraordinary artistic agency and range of expressive possibilities with those other things, actually the negation of those things, the inhuman, the things that are intangible, things that are disembodied, and so forth. But you haven't spoken of those, you haven't said anything pejorative about them, but you haven't actually spoken in some sort of redemptive way or in praise of them. And so, insofar as there's been this esteem in which you want to rehabilitate all these kind of physical, corporeal, non-abstracted qualities, I'm wondering if there is a moment that is possible in your own artistic agenda where you would say, these human qualities that I'm seeking are so profound that the project is to write music for a human that has no intangible qualities, in a sense, doesn't involve a speakers, etc. I'm actually asking this in a, I mean this sincerely, I'm not trying to...
No, sorry, I've just lost your microphone, Dave. Sorry about that. Just get that back on again. I will say no. And what this has, the implication this has for me in general artistically, is that when I first started composing, whether it was acousmatic music or for ensembles and orchestras and all sorts, I was able to work in this range when it came to my knowledge of computer tools, my ability to work with sound, my ability to orchestrate, I was there. And of course, gradually as you learn and you acquire more skills, this possibility expands. And what spatial audio has done for me, and also the investigations of this approach to tangible acousmatic sound, where there isn't the live performer in front of us, is that it has taken this point here as reality. It has expanded what that means, hyper-reality for me. So, and we could have here totally abstract, or totally non-human, or totally alienating, if you like. So what it has meant is it expanded this range of possibilities, which means that I have a far greater repertoire of choice. And that might be a greater repertoire of variation. For example, now my spatial world isn't stuck here. My spatial world has enough variation that it's almost on par with timbral variation with an orchestra. I mean, prior to this, my work with spatial variation, you could work with reverb, you could make things dry, reverberant, you can work a little bit with spatial scenes. But there really wasn't enough possibilities of variation to really work with it as an intense part of musical structure. It was more a general global sense of change. Whereas all this work has expanded this so that I am able to address musical structure and the spatial aspect of musical structure equally to how I would address structure in terms of pitch and counterpoint and timbre and other aspects of music. So I hope that explains where I'm coming from. And as I say, I write as many instrumental works as I do acousmatic works. And I think when people listen to instrumental music, they listen in a very different way because they listen with their eyes. And I don't experience instrumental music anymore as pure music unless I'm listening to it without the performers there, because I'm experiencing a multimedia situation where the visual presence is changing how I hear. But what I'm doing with this work is that there isn't the visual information anymore. And so I'm listening to that sense of human agency and tangibility in a very different way than if I had been watching performers play the piece of music on stage. To contextualize things.
What about memory?
Pardon?
What about memory?
Memory. What kind of memory?
Yeah, I find like a wonderful, it's something about the pieces that we've played here at several concerts, there's like this wonderful contradiction between reality and agency. I can hear the agency of people and movements, but I also feel sometimes that I'm the object being acted upon. So I am the drum skin. So you're collapsing dimensions. Somebody is like, oh, I know what this means. After there's something that there's these other things, entities that work on that we can't possibly experience as a human. Whereas then on this other side, and now your work, like the bee thing, although it's an impossible situation, I have a reference to the bee sound. So I have memories of that. Memories of this. It's quite what you put it in.
Yeah.
So I don't know, it's always this weird thing where I'm kind of like, yeah.
Well, I think what you're talking about in relation to memory, I think that connects maybe more to my interest in embodied cognition. Because you're alluding to the bee, you know what a bee is, and you could hear that in that piece, and that was very clear to you. However, you also have an embodiment of what the drum is.
Yeah.
And although you don't see somebody hitting the drum there, your experience of the drum isn't only your ears, it's to do with the whole physical resonating body, that you have an understanding of that, an awareness of that in the non-sounding domain, which is part of your sense of embodying that sound and that mode of articulation from a proximity which might not be the performer on stage, it might be your own physical awareness of a drum.
I don't know whether that thing, for me, is non-sounding.
Pardon?
I don't think that is a non-sounding experience for me.
Right.
I think the same as this thing here.
Yeah.
The experience of sound for me is no longer in an experience of sound.
Okay.
Actually, it's conducted with memory and these other things. And so visual representation as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I find it a fascinating and a really useful contradiction.
Mm-hmm.
Because it keeps me wanting to go to these pieces more and more and just find out what the hell is going on.
Okay.
It's like a huge conversation. But.
Well, that's why we're glad we have you around. So maybe we should
wrap it up.
Let you off the hook.
Yeah, thanks.